Welcome to the show where we share the stories of the many who intersect with our healthcare system but are rarely heard from. My name is Kevin Poe, founder and editor of Kevin MD. Today in the show, we have Miriam Zieberglate and Judith Furman. Miriam is a veteran of the show. She appeared last year. She's an internal medicine physician, and Judith is a psychotherapist. Together, they co-wrote the Kevin MD article, Take Back the Power and Joy of Being a Doctor. Miriam and Judith, welcome to the show.
Thank you for having us.
So we're going to get into your article in a little bit, but I'm going to ask each of you to share your stories and journeys to where you are today. Miriam, why don't you go first?
So I am an academic physician. I do internal medicine geriatrics, but really my heart is in academia. So I work all the time with residents and medical students, and I can see firsthand how challenging could be medical education and how challenging is the complete healthcare system today. So I am very interested right now in focusing my career, my development in wellness and leadership skills, so I can provide those to my residents and my students so they can have brighter futures and be able to really enjoy medicine and be happy and healthy.
So Miriam, we are talking towards actually the beginning of September now, and you've had new residents, certainly, you've seen over the last few months. Tell me some of the challenges that new interns are facing, especially in the light of COVID in the background.
Normally, July is a very interesting time of the year for any academic physician, for academic hospitals. Interns need to face many challenges. First of all, if they are immigrants or they are coming from another city, they need to adapt to the transition, right? To be in a new place, meet new people, sometimes understand the medical system, right, which is already complicated. The long hours are not helpful. The stress right now of getting sick or knowing that if they go back home, they can get someone that they love sick is adding extra. And I feel like there's something that is even more important. We tell residents and we tell physicians and medical students that they will be in front of death. And we are kind of, we know that that will happen, but the amount of sick people and now young people that is dying or it's in a ventilator, the emotions around that, the stress that this is causing is unprecedented. And I don't think that we prepare our residents or our interns for that. I don't think that we were prepared for seeing that either.
And Judith, can you share your story and journey to where you are today?
Yes, of course. Thank you for having us. So I'm originally from Lima, Peru. I'm a clinical psychologist and systemic family therapist. I moved to the States 15 years ago, and I needed to kind of reinvent myself again because of the differences between education and degrees in the different countries. So I had the opportunity to do something different, but I actually have my passion in mental health and in well-being. So I went back to school, I got my master's in mental health counseling, and I got a specialty in positive psychology. That is something that I'm very passionate about. Right now I work in private practice, and I also am the director of counseling at a school in Fort Lauderdale. So I'm very passionate about working with students and trying to increase their well-being. We all know that it all starts in the young age. So trying to make an impact and really make sure that the kids have the skills that they need to develop, you know, themselves and be able to handle whatever the world throws at them. And like right now with resilience, it's a big topic. And I know that we're going to be discussing a little bit more later on regarding to the article, but I think that there's so much that needs to be done in the preventive side and not focusing only on the intervention in the future when things are going wrong, but more in preventing and providing the skills that are needed.
And Judith, of course, we're entering a really uncertain school year, especially what we've been through over the last 18 months. Mm-hmm. So what kind of advice are you giving to these new students who may be coming back from a year of remote learning and now going mm-hmm. into in-person learning for the first time in what could be over a year? What kind of advice are you giving them?
So it's interesting because I work with students K through eight. So we have like all the range, and with the little ones, it's a little more difficult in really like processing with words what is happening. So a lot is going into also helping the staff, like the teachers, the administration, and also helping the parents to support the students and to really like give them the tools that they need. In terms of the advice, I always say like, feel your feelings. It's okay. Like not everything is gonna be happiness and rainbows and butterflies, but is just able to feel it and to do something with it. So instead of just trying to avoid the negative, is if you're having a negative feeling, just seek help, use your tools, use your strategies. There's a big support system around you. So I think that the message is more about, we're here for you, we're in this together, and just providing them all the tools that they need to be successful.
All right, now both of you co-wrote the Kevin MD article, Take Back the Power and Joy of Being a Doctor. Miriam, I'm going to ask you, for those who didn't get a chance to read that article, can you just walk my audience through it and share why you and you decided to write it?
When I started writing this article, I was going through a frustration mode. And again, as I mentioned the last time that we were together, I write as part of psychotherapy. And I was trying to convince myself and also those that are around me that we have power. We have the power to control what happens to us, that we are not victims, and that it's easier to blame the system. I will agree that the system is absolutely corrupted and there are many things going wrong around us in the medical field. But I just can't accept that the medical system will decide how happy I am, how healthy I am, how good physician I am. And the idea was to empower others to recover that control, to know that they can take their own decisions. And that there are, as Judith mentioned, there are certain tools, right? From just using support, psychological support, to have friends around you. But probably the most important are the ones that we have inside of us, right? Our resilience, our ability to grow even when we're in front of adversity, which is called post-traumatic growth, our emotional intelligence that allows us to be self-aware and to understand where are our gaps and to understand also what is happening around us and to be able to adapt. And something that I learned actually from Judith that was very interesting for me is your locus of control, right? What you can control and what to do with those things that you cannot control and know when to let go certain things so you keep your sanity. Doctors, we are privileged to have the opportunity to save lives, to help people, always be there for others, teach, do research. We are just chameleons. We can transform ourselves in so many things at the same time. But if we don't take care of ourselves and if we don't recover the power, if we are not happy and healthy, we will not be able to continue helping others. And we need to recognize that.
When it comes to clinician burnout, there's always that tension, right, between the system and our resilience and what we can do to control that. So what are some ways that clinicians can really, you know, take control? What are some internal things that they could like change that framework where they can better survive burnout?
Seeing it from the outside, because I'm not a physician, but you know, I have a relationship with someone that is a physician, but I think that a lot of pressure goes into doctors. You know, like they have their responsibility and the privilege of saving lives, but also many times we see them as these kind of superheroes or gods, that they have all the answers and that they can do everything and anything needed, you know, to help people. And that puts a lot of pressure on themselves. And I think that it's very important to recognize what is in your hands and what you can do and what is in your control and what is not. And the system, maybe you cannot modify the system, but you can modify the way that you handle the situations or the way that you react to the injustices or to things that are happening that maybe you don't agree with. So I think that it's more about really looking into yourself and recognizing what you can do, how you can do it, how you can contribute, and also taking care of yourself. There's a lot of, I'm going to do this for you, but not what am I going to do for myself. And we tend to be very kind to other people, but we are not kind to ourselves. And I think that that is one of the main reasons why there's so much burnout, because they are just like focusing so much on others and they are not focusing on themselves. And I always give like the example of when you're in an airplane and, you know, the oxygen like comes down, like first you need to put it on yourself and then you can help the person that is next to you. So this is exactly what physicians and honestly, like anyone like should be doing. Like it's not selfish. It's just the only way that you can help others is to make sure that you are okay first. And in terms of resilience, I think that everything kind of, it's related. Resilience is something that you can learn. For some people come more naturally and, you know, they are just able to bounce back really quickly, maybe because of, you know, the way that they see life, their past experiences. For others, it takes a little, you know, much work, but I think that in general, it's something that we can learn and that we can practice and that we can get better at. So I think that at the end of the day, it's just recognizing that we're just human and that we do the best that we can.
Miriam, sometimes in the heat of the moment during a busy day or if something doesn't go well clinically, it's sometimes hard to think back to your article and think back to some of the things that we can do to kind of help remove us from the situation. Can you give us a case study or an example of how a busy physician or medical student or resident, for that matter, can implement some of these techniques sometimes in the heat of the moment when everything isn't going the way they want?
I am not right now in my office, but if you will go to my office, what you will see is that all my walls are full of pictures of my residents, cards from my patients, and I have a special wall for my family. When I'm having a very challenging day, I take a few seconds and I go around and I see those pictures and I try to focus in why I am doing what I am doing. I go to my core values. I go to back to my dreams and who I am. And that's my best technique, is to recognize that even in the challenging days, I know who I am. I know why I'm doing this. I know why I'm sacrificing and I know why I'm tolerating. And I use that as a motivation also, because I kind of understand that it's not just me. I cannot get a tantrum in the middle of the day. There are people around me that depend on me and I need to be the role model. So I will say that that's number one. Number two, I just recognize my gaps. I am very transparent with that. If I don't know, I don't know. If I am afraid, I am afraid. If I know that I am going to a difficult encounter, you will laugh, but I will shake myself before I go into that door and that room, knowing that I will need to have extra energy. And I prepare myself. I believe that if you are self-aware and you understand that the situation is complicated, you admit that, then you put those feelings, negative feelings, in a box, you close that box, and then you go into a room and you interact with your patients, you will remove bias, which is such an important thing to do. You will have more control of what you are doing and what you are saying and how you are acting, and you will be the physician that you want to be. And if you need to come back to your office and remove those feelings again from the box and start crying or doing whatever you need, do it. But keep it professional and be sure that priority number one is to take care of your patients. And for me, the same level of priority is to take care of my residents and my students.
Judith, I'm going to ask you that same question from your perspective as a psychotherapist. Are there any specific psychotherapy techniques that you could advise clinicians if they're in the heat of the moment and having just a terrible day and may lose perspective and may not think about some of the things that you wrote in the article?
So in the heat of the moment, it sounds very simple, but it could be difficult. It's just breathe. You know, sometimes it's just take a moment, take a deep breath, center yourself, connect with yourself, and just like give yourself like those 10 seconds that maybe are going to make a huge difference. So I said that it's very simple, but it's very complicated, because I think that we forget about the power of breathing and just like centering yourself. But that would be my number one. Like that's something that works with children, with adults. I think that we've all been there in some way, and just like pausing. Probably you as physicians know better than me, but you know, your brain just need that space to kind of activate and make better choices. So I think that that's number one. In terms of other things that you can do, maybe not in the heat of the moment, but in general, I think that some simple things like practicing gratitude, just like being thankful for what you have, appreciating, you know, what you have around you, the privilege that you have of being a doctor and being in that position of saving lives that, you know, it's so special. And also thinking about your relationships, like the positive relationships that you have. I think that support systems are extremely important. And I know that it could be sometimes being a physician and the long hours could be very lonely, but just like knowing that you have a support system, and sometimes it's your family, sometimes it's your extended family, like your colleagues, but just relying on them and asking for help if you need it. No one is expecting perfection. No one is expecting, you know, this kind of superhero that I think that you are in many ways, but definitely you're human. So it's just like going back to those basics and just connecting to yourself, connecting to the people around you, and just being grateful for what you have.
We're talking to Miriam Zilberglate and Judith Furman. Miriam is an internal medicine physician and Judith is a psychotherapist. And together they co-wrote to Kevin M. the article, Take Back the Power and Joy of Being a Doctor. Miriam, one of the biggest problems that I think people in medicine have is really asking for help, when to seek help. There's a lot of stigma when it comes to burnout and behavioral health issues. So when you advised your medical students and residents and fellow clinicians about seeking help, what kind of advice do you give them and when should they seek help?
So what you're saying is so true, right? We have many challenges, and this comes from not only the feeling of, again, being superheroes, so we are not allowed to be vulnerable, that shows weakness, but also there is some limitations in the system. Majority of the states in this country will need physicians to fill in the when they are processing their licenses, if they were treated by a psychologist or psychiatrist, right? So we need to disclose something that I don't think that in any other type of career, a lawyer or a teacher needs to say if they had any medical or psychological condition in the past. And that creates a lot of fear. Doctors, they don't want to ask for help, or they don't want this to be in records. So that limits the access to help. And it's a big challenge. I think this is something that we need to reconsider. I believe that there's a group of people already working on trying to make some changes in this regard. So it's something that needs to be urgently fixed. What I tell to my residents or students, number one, is I am always available, that anything that happens in my office is HIPAA protected. They are not expected to be perfect and that they need to ask for help. The first steps is to talk with friends and family, but gets to a point that friends and family is not enough and that they need to get psychological therapy or even to get in touch with psychiatrists, and that it's better to do that before things happen. I part of our article mentions the rate of burnout that is around the 40%, which is very high. And this is not related to COVID. I want to clarify that these numbers are not because of COVID. These numbers are almost similar to before COVID. Mm-hmm. There is a recent survey, more than 10,000 of physicians were asked about suicidal ideation, and 13% of them answered that, yes, they thought about committing suicide, and then you have 1% that attempted. We have 300 to 400 physicians that die per year in this country. And this is not only medical students or residents. Actually, the average age for committing suicide in physicians is 40 to 50s. And I don't see that in the news. And it's not that it's something that we need to be proud and we want to spread, but I don't see people talking about this. And I don't see people being concerned about this. And my biggest concern is not only the lives and the suffering of those that commit suicide and their families, but I think also about what happened before that. One of the most frequent causes of mortality in this country is medical errors. And probably these are related to, we assume that these are related to physician burnout. Mm-hmm. So we are not only talking about 400 individuals that die because they are suffering as physicians. We are talking about what happened before, how many patients maybe they harm while trying to be superheroes and multitask and be there for long hours. So this is a epidemia as bad as COVID. And this is a public health situation that we need to target and we need to fix, because removing myself from the position, I am a physician, but we need our physicians to be healthy, and we need our physicians to be in a situation where they can really keep saving life and helping others. And I don't think that there is where we are right now.
So I'm going to ask each of you now your take-home messages that you want to leave with the KevinMD audience. Judith, we'll start with you.
So I think that I'm going to go back to something that I mentioned before. I think that the most important thing is to give permission to be human. Like, I remember when I did my certification in positive psychology, they told me, if there's one thing that we want you to take away from all this, you know, long studying, is that we are humans and we need to give permission to ourselves to feel and to live and to realize that we are not perfect and that we're going to make mistakes, that we're going to need help. Going back to the stigma that you were mentioning before, I think that it's always perceived like asking for help as a weakness, and we need to change that narrative. So I believe that the most important thing is accept yourself, love yourself, be kind to yourself. It's easier to do it with others, but not to yourself. So I would say that self-care is extremely important, and just like do what you love, do it with all your passion, take that joy back, like we say in the article, but really like feel it and go back to the reasons why you chose that career. Look back at what motivated you to go through so many years of medical school and so many sleepless nights, and what was really your motivation and your passion, and just like recover that. Because I think that in the, you know, in the days go by, the weeks go by, you get tired, it's exhausting in many ways. Sometimes you get discouraged and you forget that. So going back to those moments is extremely important.
And Miriam, what's your take-home message that you want to leave with the KevinMD audience?
I believe that we need to recognize who we are, be self-aware, and understand and recover our values, our dreams, recover the power, stop being victims. We are not victims. We are smart people, and we are good people, and we are doing amazing things. We need to be proud of ourselves, and we need to recognize that in a humble way too, right? Because it's such a privilege and an honor, but it's also a responsibility, and we need to be responsible. And we need to take care of ourselves so we can do our job correctly. I want to use this opportunity also to create some awareness. September 17 is the day of physician suicide awareness. Please pay attention to your colleagues, pay attention to your medical students, your residents, pay attention to yourself. Don't be part of the statistics. Be someone that not only survive medicine or survive life, but actually that enjoys it. We don't need to keep seeing doctors jumping out of buildings. That's not acceptable. Don't be part of the problem, but don't be also quiet and just ignore it. We need each of us to collaborate, to help, to be proactive. We cannot just say, this is not affecting me directly. I am not a victim of microaggression today, or I have a good salary, or my schedule is good, so I will not get involved. We are a community, the community of physicians or community of healthcare workers, because really this affects all of us. And we need to act as a community. We need to act as a family, and we need to advocate for each other.
Miriam and Judith, thank you so much for sharing your time and insight. And thanks again for being on the show.
Thank